All right. So when I saw this on eBay, would I buy it now for $15? I knew I had to have it. So let's open it up in fast motion. Now, I ended up getting a couple of battle scars from opening this particular item, but not as much as she actually had in real life. So what we have here is the Maid of Orleans, otherwise known as Joan of Arc. Joan of Arc was born in 1412 and died in 1431 at 19 years old. At the age of 17, she entered into battle against the English. She was French, and she wanted to help take back the city of Orleans. Now, it was the Hundred Year War against the British, and she really was quite the person. Let's just put it this way. Pope Benedict XV canonized her as a saint on May 16th, 1920. So she was visited by three saints, St. Michael, St. Margaret, and St. Catherine, although she alludes to. She was actually burned at the stake for being a heretic, and for being a heretic and for cross-dressing boys and girls. And so we'll find out more. We're going to watch a video. There's actually a song from the 80s, which was fantastic, by OMD. We're going to watch the Maid of Orleans video, if Vivo will allow it. And also, we're going to actually watch a quick video about this particular saint. Now, she was a woman who was a mighty woman, and she cross-dressed like a man and went into battle. Now, what we have here is her, actually, her effigy on a horse. Let's go ahead and take a look at this. How old is this? We're going to figure this out in a moment. And you see her with a sword and her banner on the very top. This is a token. This is definitely French. And, well, we got a sea closure on one side. That generally... A sea closure was generally during the Victorian era and earlier, but we have a round hinge. So that actually aims towards the late 1890s. Before that was tube hinges. And then this is not a mass-produced round hinge. So I would probably say that this was probably made between 1890 to about 1920. It's very hard to pin an exact date on this, but we do notice that the pin juts out. Wait, let me get my bandaged hand out of the way because it's embarrassing. But if you notice, the pin juts out past the brooch. That tells me that it's old. During the Victorian era, it was actually, they used very thick cloth. So they had to use very thick pins to attach to the fabric and actually puncture and go through the fabric. You can see this is a thick pin. During the Edwardian time, which is the late, well, actually, the 20th century, about 1901 to about, I forgot, I think it goes up to about, like, around World War I. The clothing was much thinner, mostly made with, like, light lawn or linen. And then you didn't need pins that were this strong to get through the clothes. But there is no markings on this. I believe this may be silver or silver plated. This is really quite cool. Oops. And I'm going to quickly show you some of the prices these sell for. Here's one that was actually polished, being sold for $238.55. I don't know if you can see that. And this one is her with her banner. And these would be souvenirs, actually. I don't think this was made for the canonization of her, which was in 1920. But this is actually on sale. It was $265. You have 3 hours and 5 minutes and 55 seconds to get it for this price, and 10% off, boys and girls. And so this is actually, people would take a tour of Europe and bring back a souvenir from Europe. So this is most likely what's known as a, what do they call that again? I'm having a senior moment. It's called a Grand Tour antique. And here we see the backing, very similar to mine with the round hinge. Some of these had tube hinges. And generally, that would date these to about the 1890s to the early 20th century. And yeah, if you have $238.55, which I don't, I much enjoy getting my stuff for only $15 hairs on eBay. And here's another version, which is similar to the other one we just saw on Etsy. The $259 being sold in France. This one is dirty and has not been polished. And generally, a lot of these would have a name of the town of France somebody would visit for a grand tour or an actual souvenir. And Joan of Arc was very popular in France. So if you're a big fan of Joan, you can get a lot of antique Joan of Arc items and medals and medallions. For example, this really cool bracelet, 725 doll hairs. We have right here a pendant that looks like it's silver or silver plated, going for 290. Another pendant that looks like it's silver, 325 doll hairs. And there's lots of Joan of Arc things that you can get, which can be affordable as well. $45 here, down to $95 for this brooch. Oh, and look, we got this one. This is a town of Domremy in France, and it's the same exact brooch as mine, but it has the name of the town, which is a souvenir piece you can get for $50. And we see many different prices, 95 doll hairs, 65 doll hairs. We see another $55 brooch. Here's another one, $65, another town in France. So this is telling me these were souvenir pieces of France. Very interesting. Here's a 1920s piece with marcasites, going for 65 doll hairs. It's a brooch. Here we have an $85 medallion. And let's keep going, $45 for this one. We have $150 for this, like, it looks like a brooch. Yes, this brooch, 150 doll hairs. And the prices are all over the place for Joan of Arc collectibles. As you can see here, $140 for this brooch, as opposed to $55 for this one, as opposed to $725 for that one, which might be real gold, or $160 for this necklace pendant. And as you can see, the prices are just everywhere, boys and girls. So I think I got a good deal for 15 doll hairs. Look at all the detail on this brooch. It is very small. It's probably about an inch and a quarter. But look at the detail. Now, on the top of her banner, it says in French, J-E-S, Marie, Maria. And I don't know what the heck that means, but so this was definitely something that somebody took back as a souvenir from their trip to France. And Joan of Arc is actually amazing. So we're going to go ahead to a cutaway. We're going to watch the OMD video. I don't know if Vivo is going to probably strike me, but I don't make any money on my channel, so screw them. And also we're going to watch some historian do a 5-minute video about the story of Joan of Arc, who may have been schizophrenic, and we'll find out why. Why was she possibly schizophrenic, hearing voices and seeing things? It's up to you to decide. And how she got actually burned for being a heretic, and for cross-dressing. Yes, cross-dressing. And so this saint is really amazing because she led France into battle and won so many battles. So let's go ahead and scan on over there. Please give that guy an actual subscribe. I'll put a link in the description below because he explains the history of Joan so well in like under 5 minutes.
d'Arc, also known as the Maid of Orleans, was a semi-legendary figure who took part in the Hundred Years' War, which is a very, very long, complicated conflict that makes Game of Thrones look straightforward. Today, we're going to be talking about Joan of Arc. Joan of Arc was born in 1412 in an itty-bitty little village to a couple whose only accomplishments that we remember were giving birth to Joan of Arc. Her first 13 years were pretty quiet. She learned to spin wool, be a good Catholic, then suddenly, bam, saints everywhere. Joan claimed that three saints came to visit her. St. Margaret, St. Catherine, and St. Michael. And apparently, those saints told her to get those damn Englishmen off their lawn. Because, you know, at the time, the English were occupying a lot of France. When she was 16, she made her way to the nearest town that actually had a military presence, went to the garrison and talked to the commander, and basically said, "Yo, I need to see the king." And he was just like, no, but that didn't stop her. A couple months later, she returned with the support of a couple soldiers. Due to the support she received from these two soldiers, she got a meeting with the garrison commander. And in her meeting with the commander, she accurately predicted the outcome of a nearby battle that the French would lose. Considering how far away the battle was, and considering that a runner wouldn't appear for another couple days with the news, the commander decided that she was indeed being guided by God, and that it was divine intervention that led her to accurately predict the outcome of this battle. Joan was then escorted to the royal court. Now, to get there, they actually had to pass through hostile territory. So what they did was they dressed Joan as a male soldier. Now, this was actually a pretty common tactic back then when civilians needed to pass through hostile territory. Unfortunately, this actually did get her in a little bit of trouble later. When she arrived, she was granted a private meeting with King Charles VII, who apparently she impressed so much that he gave her armor, weapons, a horse, and permission to visit Orleans, a city that had been under siege for 6 months, and was so strategically important that if they lost the city, they'll likely lose the war. At Orleans, Joan attended war councils and actually participated in battles, despite the fact that the acting commander at first did his best to exclude her. As for her actual participation in battles, according to most accounts, Joan always said that she only ever carried a banner and never killed anyone. The battles were always commanded by some lord or another, but the records show that these lords actually did respect her opinion and listen to her advice. Now, you might be wondering why anybody actually decided to trust her, because, you know, she was some uneducated teenager from the middle of nowhere who was claiming to see saints and hear the voice of God. Now, I don't know about you, but that's not exactly a resume I would trust. Think about it this way. The French had been losing a lot lately. It was humiliating and degrading. Every conventional tactic was failing. Maybe it was time to try something a little unconventional, like trust some teenager with no battle experience. But despite the apparent insanity behind this idea, it seemed to be working. The French started pushing back. They started recapturing fortresses and they started winning battles. And people at the time actually accredited their success directly to Joan. That siege had been happening for 6 months, but 9 days after her arrival, it was done. Joan then accompanied several more campaigns, accepting surrender over surrender and gaining the trust of the lords that led those campaigns. Eventually, something had to go wrong, and during an attack on an enemy camp, Joan was captured and imprisoned. Now, to her credit, she did try to escape, like a whole bunch of times, including one time where she jumped off of a 70-foot tower. Unfortunately, all of her attempts were unsuccessful. And it wasn't just her making these attempts. The French tried to rescue her a couple times, and again, were unsuccessful. Joan's captors eventually ransomed her to the English, who put her on trial for heresy and cross-dressing. They put her on trial, found her guilty, and burned her at the stake. After the war ended, Joan was given a retrial, and she was found not guilty and absolved of all crimes. But her posthumous honor didn't stop there. In 1909, she was canonized as an official Catholic saint. When it comes to Joan's visions, there's not really a clear historical consensus about what caused them. Some people actually do believe that she was talking to God and talking to saints. Others believe she most likely had a mental illness, some form of schizophrenia, and others believe that there was likely a tumor pressing on her brain causing her to see and hear things. But there are arguments against every single one of these cases. The truth of the matter is we will probably never know for sure what exactly caused Joan's visions. Thanks for watching, everybody. This was The Life of Joan of Arc, Abridged.
Huge fan of Joan of Arc, a warrior, an absolute warrior. It sends shivers down my spine. And I hope you watched thoroughly the video of Joan of Arc for the actual OMD video, it just gave me shivers with the bagpipes going and all that other stuff. Amazing. OMD was an amazing band. And so I cleaned this up with Simicrone, and you can see it's shiny now. It's nice and shine. And I did test it. It is silver. And that's why it was so blackened. Now, I did not take all the patina off of it. When you have something that's really, really old, try not to take all the patina off of it, because it actually, I like the age on things, but it was so black, I couldn't even see the detail. And so I did clean it. And I did not clean the back, because we want to show that age. We want to show that this is a very, very old piece. My guess, once again, 1890 to about 1920. I'm going to guess it's on the older side. And you can find one of these yourself, too, if you hunt enough on eBay or on Etsy or on Mercari or any of those other websites. You can actually find a lot of people would not actually recognize this famous historical saint. And you can probably get your own for about $15, too, if you look hard enough. I had to go through 15,000 eBay listings until I found an affordable one. And that's quite the feat. So this was not easy to find, this little thing, for $15. So thanks for watching. Give that other guy a subscribe, because, you know, I actually liked his content. And I'll see you on the next unboxing, which should be coming soon.